Yeah. I don't know if I need this, but this is to get everyone's attention. So I'm sorry about the delay. We took longer than we thought. So as soon as Rohit is ready, we'll start off. And so when Rohit is not there, I can say whatever I please. So let me introduce Rohit Parikh to people who will... to the TARC audience, you know, there is this cliche thing about the speaker not needing any introduction. But I think this is certainly true of Rohit Parikh for TARC. The first TARC had a banquet talk by Raymond Smullyan. And I don't know if other TARCs have had banquets, but for the first time TARC coming to India, it was appropriate that we should have Rohit giving this banquet talk here. He has been contributing to, it's difficult to describe Rohit as a, you know, any one particular thing. He has contributed to, fundamentally to logic, computer science, aspects of philosophy, game theory, and now artificial intelligence, linguistics. So I'm trying to list the areas that you have contributed to only till you came, that's all. So in some sense, along with TARC, Rohit has been responsible for building theories of knowledge and reasoning about knowledge. And I think as Joe was mentioning about different directions that TARC has been taking, I think Rohit has been leading in all these fronts as well. So earlier he was talking about how TARC should reach out to more disciplines and ideas. And I think today's talk he's going to do precisely that, to set an agenda for the TARC community to look at other topics.
How is that? That's better. Okay, good. The day is full of mischief, yes? All right, so what I want to do is to talk about use of epistemic logic or epistemic reasoning by, you know, by various writers, starting maybe with Shakespeare and even earlier. Now, the general issue is how far can logic or formal reasoning help us understanding actual human behavior? And of course, this morning, then Rinneke talked also about understanding the behavior of crows. So let's suppose someone has just poured a cup of coffee and is stretching out her hand. We can reasonably conclude that she's looking for milk or sugar, or perhaps equal the sugarless. If we know her well, we can even be sure that it's not milk to which she's allergic. So reasoning and previously known facts form a backdrop which allows us to reduce the enormous complexity of the social world. Because we need to deal with other people and we need to be able to predict what they will do in order to coordinate our actions with theirs. And similarly, they need to do the same with us. So this results in a kind of a circle of mutual understanding. Now, so we'll talk about examples from real life or from literature which show how epistemic reasoning helps us reason about other people. Now, the expression theory of mind was coined by Primark and Woodruff to describe the phenomenon where we represent another's mind and maybe even represent the representation of our mind, and maybe further on. Now, Wimmer and Perner in their classic false belief paper showed that children under the age of 4 are unable to represent the minds of others who have false beliefs that they themselves know the truth. While Wimmer Perner, for instance, talk about children, it's known from experiments, e.g. by Ferbrugge and colleagues, that adults are far from perfect and fail to reach levels of mind more than 2 or 3. So many examples of epistemic reasoning in real life and literature involve the theory of mind, and sometimes one may know someone well enough to know when they are not using the theory of mind, but examples do not come really to mind. Now, one class of people who are defective in this way are people who are autistic, who have excellent understanding of the physical world, but often lack even the most elementary understanding of other people. So Temple Grandin, who is both artistic and a well-respected scholar. She's a professor at the University of Arizona. She would probably be a source of examples, but surely it would not be ethical to take advantage of people who lack Tom and can easily be taken in. For example, Oliver Sacks went to Arizona to see her, and he was in her office for several hours. He had had a long flight, and she never asked him if whether he even wanted a glass of water or a cup of coffee, right? So it's this kind of a thing which autistic people tend to have. Now, Temple has great difficulty in figuring out what adults and children are up to, but she has enormous communication and empathy with animals, and she has worked out methods to ease the last moments on Earth of animals bound for slaughter. Okay, so now we come to some classical examples. So the first example is from Shakespeare's Much Ado About Nothing. There will be two examples from Shakespeare. The first one is at Messina, a messenger brings news that Don Pedro, a Spanish prince from Aragon, and his officers Claudio and Benedict have returned from a successful battle. So Leonardo, the governor of Messina, welcomes the messenger and announces that Don Pedro and his men will stay for a month. Okay, now Beatrice is Leonardo's niece, and she asks the messenger about Benedict. Now these two people are in a certain sense the focus of the play because of their habit of making sarcastic remarks about each other, especially Beatrice about Benedict. And nonetheless, there is a feeling that the apparent contempt on the surface hides love underneath. So Leonardo says there's a kind of merry war between Signor Benedict and her. Now, various events take place, and Claudio wins the hand in marriage of Hero, Leonardo's only daughter, and the wedding is to take place in a week. So that's the situation. These people have arrived after winning a battle. Claudio wins the hand of Hero, and now marriage is to take place in a week. What to do for the week? So Don Pedro and his men, bored at the prospect of waiting a week for the wedding, hatch a plan to matchmake between Beatrice and Benedict, who inwardly love each other but outwardly display contempt for each other. So according to this stratagem, the men led by Don Pedro proclaim Beatrice's love for Benedict while knowing he's eavesdropping in their conversation. So he's hidden behind the bushes, they're talking about Beatrice's love for him, and he doesn't know that they know that he's there. So thus we have, using B for Benedict and D for Don Pedro and E for the event of eavesdropping, Benedict knows about E, Don Pedro knows about E, but Benedict does not know that Don Pedro knows about E. All these conditions are essential, and of course the plot would be spoiled if we had KBKDE instead of not KBKDE. Why? Because if Benedict knew that they were putting this on for his benefit, he would be suspicious and would not believe what they were saying. So the women led by Hero carry on a similar charade for Beatrice, and Beatrice and Benedict are now convinced that their own love is returned and hence decide to requite the love of the other. And the play ends with all four lovers getting married. So let's look at this game theory. This is decision theory. Benedict's decision problem depends on the conditions, whether Beatrice loves him or not. If she loves him, then it's wonderful for him to propose to her. They can get married and his utility is 100. If she loves him and he doesn't propose, then he loses out somebody he loves. So that's minus 2. If she doesn't love him and he doesn't propose, nothing gained, nothing lost. But if she doesn't love him and proposes, then of course he will be humiliated, and so there's a payoff of minus 20. Okay. Now the default belief for him is no love, especially when it's buttressed by the sarcastic remark. So in the no love column, which is the right column, his dominant strategy is to not propose. However, if he comes to believe that she loves him, action changes to the left column, and in the left column, his dominant strategy is to propose. So once these people convince him that she loves him, his dominant strategy changes, he proposes to her, and they get married. Now, this has Beatrice has a similar decision problem, whether she proposes him or doesn't propose him. If he proposes to her or doesn't propose. If she doesn't propose, then she might as well enjoy ridiculing him. But if he does propose, then she loves him, so she should accept. Now here, we have a sequence of three events. The first event is the hatching of the plot. Let's call this event E1. The second event is Benedict hiding behind the bushes, and the third event is the conversation, right? So this is the global history, but according to the semantics that Ram and I worked out, the local history for Benedict is only the last two events, right? And given the last two events, hiding behind the bushes and hearing the conversation, his default about the global history is that the conversation is sincere and she loves him. So we have a construction of a global history on the basis of a local history, and the global history gives Benedict a belief which is true and justified. It's not knowledge because it's based on a false influence. Okay. Now we come to a second writer, a more recent one, Bernard Shaw. So in this play, rich businessman Mr. Crampton is estranged from his wife, although being English, they are cordial to each other in a kind of a cold way. And he has not seen his three children for many years. The three children in question are Gloria, the oldest, who is beautiful, and Dolly and Philip, who are what we might describe as good-natured brats. So they're always doing a certain amount of mischief. It so happens that a meeting is now being arranged in the restaurant between the mother and the three children on one side and Mr. Crampton on the other. The woman's interest is that Mr. Crampton is very rich and she wants money for the children, and Mr. Crampton, on the other hand, wants contact with his own children. So there is a certain amount of negotiating having to go on. So the conversation below takes place just before Mr. Crampton arrives. William is a sagacious waiter and McComas is a family friend. Now remember that Mr. Crampton has not seen his children for about 20 years or so. So of course he doesn't know what they look like. So Philip says, Mr. Crampton is coming to lunch with us. And the waiter is puzzled. He says, yes, sir. Don't you usually lunch with his family, perhaps, sir? And Philip says, William, he does not know that we are his family. He has not seen him for 18 years. He won't know us. And to emphasize this communication, he seats himself on the iron table with a spring and looks at the waiter with his lips compressed and his legs swinging. So this is the way in which young people try to impress older people. Now, Dolly says, we want you to break the news to him, William. And waiter says, but I should think he had guessed when he sees your mother, miss. And Philip's legs become motionless at this elucidation. He contemplates the waiter raptly. Dolly says, I never thought of that. Philip, nor I. And he says to McComas, nor you. So it's obvious that what the waiter is saying makes perfect sense. Because even though his wife has aged 20 years, nonetheless, the appearance should be very reasonably similar. He would recognize her, whereas the children are, of course, not recognizable. So, Dolly and Philip, it's not so much that they lack logical omniscience, but they lack theory of mind. They are unable to put themselves in their father's shoes and make the inference that he will make. So, can we formalize William's inference? And a hint of the direction in which we might proceed occurs in a paper in the Review of Symbolic Logic. So suppose that Vikram believes it's not raining. In that case, you'll be in a belief state B, such that the choice between taking umbrella and not taking umbrella will be not taking umbrella. And he will go into state B prime, where he has already made a decision. Now, suppose he looks out the window and sees drops of rain falling. So let R be the event of rain falling. Then the update operation causes him to go into a state such that in that new state, he chooses you from the set you, not you. So once he witnesses this event of raindrops falling, his state of mind changes and his choice changes. Right? So this is an aspect that we ought to look at more in our reasoning, because our reasoning tends to primarily talk about beliefs changing as a result of hearing a sentence, but sometimes beliefs change as a result of something happening. Now it's clear that Mr. Crampton will recognize his wife anymore. And we'll guess that the three young adults are his children. Okay, now another play by Shaw, The Man of Destiny, also has some epistemic considerations. So now Napoleon was married to Josephine, but apparently she was not always faithful to him. And now he's away, in his campaign, he's about to attack Italy or something like that. And a letter arrives detailing his wife's infidelities. Now a pretty woman, presumably a friend of Josephine, appears before Napoleon reads the letter and tries to use her beauty and her intelligence to talk him out of reading it. So at one stage, Napoleon says, he's talking about, should he read this letter or not read the letter? Because the woman tries to get it away from him, but she doesn't quite succeed. And he says, He says, come, I'm a true Corsican in stories, but I could tell them better than you if I set my mind to it. Next time you're asked why a letter compromising a wife should not be sent to her husband, answer simply that the husband would not read it. Do you suppose, little innocent, that a man wants to be compelled by public opinion to make a scene, to fight a duel, to break up his household, to injure his career by scandal, when he can avoid it all by taking care not to know? So this is also an application by Bernard Shaw of a certain kind of complex epistemic logic, where it's like a man who knows makes sure that he doesn't. Now, in one of his papers, Nyman suggested that Napoleon's worries are unjustified, that what the husband should fear is not that he himself knows, but that others know he knows, because they would put pressure on him. Now, however, Napoleon realizes this full well. He does read the letter, but he says he's not going to read it. And then he walks out into the garden with the letter in his pocket, and then he reads it in the garden and he comes back. Okay. Now, this Hamlet's trick is something that probably most here are familiar with. So, Hamlet arrives back in Denmark to find that his father is dead, ostensibly bitten by a poisonous snake as he slept in the garden. His father's brother Claudius is now king and has married Hamlet's mother. Naturally, Hamlet is not too pleased at these events and wonders if he has come to attend his father's funeral or his mother's wedding. He says that, so I don't know whether I've come for the wedding. At this, a ghost claiming to be Hamlet's father appears on the ramparts of the castle Elsinore and tells Hamlet a rather different story of his father's death. So here's what the ghost says. Now Hamlet, here, is given out that sleeping in my orchard, a serpent stung me, so the whole ear of Denmark is by a forged process of my death, rankly abused. But know thou, noble youth, the serpent that did sting thy father's life now wears his crown. So Hamlet should avenge his father's death by killing his killer Claudius, who is his uncle. But can Hamlet trust the ghost? He says to himself, the spirit that I have seen may be the devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape. Yea, and perhaps out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, abuses me to damn me. So the ghost may not be Hamlet's father, it may be the devil. So Hamlet decides this trick. He says, I've heard that guilty creatures sitting at a play have, by the very cunning of the scene, been struck so to the soul that presently they have proclaimed their malefactions. For murder, though it have no tongue, will speak with most miraculous organ. I'll have these players play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle. I'll observe his looks. I'll tent him to the quick. If he but blench, I know my course. So I'll have grounds more relative than this. The play is the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king. So he puts on a play which enacts the kind of thing that the ghost had related to him and watches his uncle to see how he's going to react. So the king does indeed react with shock and dismay, and the ghost is proved right. So let G mean that the ghost is right, let N mean that the Claudius acts normally, and D mean that he acts with shock and dismay. So Hamlet's theory consists of two formulas. Negation G implies J. If the ghost is wrong, then the king will act normally. And if the ghost is right, then the king will act with dismay. Since Hamlet observes D, and hence negation of N, G follows, the ghost and Hamlet's course is clear. However, as many of you know, Hamlet is neurotic. So Hamlet continues to act with hesitation, refuses to kill Claudius when the letter is in prayer. For that would send him to heaven, which he does not deserve. And so eventually, the play ends in tragedy. Claudius does indeed die, but so does Hamlet himself, his mother Gertrude, and a few others who are innocent in the affair. So Hamlet's reasoning goes beyond pure epistemic logic into something deeper. Claudius's reaction is not that of his rational, thoughtful sense, who might have seen through Hamlet's trick and maintained a poker face. It's the reaction of a man caught by surprise, whose rational self is momentarily overcome. Now, this sort of issue is addressed by Daniel Kahneman, who won the Nobel Prize for Economics in 2002. In his recent book, Thinking Fast and Slow, he talks about the automatic system one and the more thoughtful system two. Now, the thoughtful system is very slow, and it typically does not oversee system one. So a lot of the time, system one acts without, as it were, the supervisor interfering. So when Claudius sees the play, his system takes takes over and he betrays himself to Hamlet. Now, Birbal was a minister at King Akbar's court and is known for many, many Birbal stories where he displays his wit and intelligence. So in this story, a man comes to Akbar's court speaking many languages fluently and challenges the courtiers to guess what his mother tongue is. None of the courtiers are able to guess with certainty. His command of all these languages is so firm. So what does Birbal do? He solves the problem by arranging for someone to throw cold water on the man as he's sleeping. The startled visitor reverts to his mother tongue. So the man is reduced to system one because he's sleeping in cold water. Okay. Now, among Sherlock Holmes stories, Silver Blaze, I think, is the most wonderful example of epistemic logic at work. So a horse, Silver Blaze, the favorite in a forthcoming race, is missing, and his trainer, Mr. Straker, is found dead on the moor, killed by a blow from some blunt instrument. Among the contents is a receipt for dress costing 22 guineas. But the receipt is in the name of Mr. Derbyshire, not Straker, and 22 guineas is rather a high price in Holmes's times. So wanting to find out if the dress is for Straker's wife, Holmes tricks her into revealing the fact that it isn't. A direct question would make her suspicious, just like the other situation. So, no, Mrs. Straker, but Mr. Holmes here has come from London to help me, and we shall do all that is possible. So Holmes says, surely I met you in Plymouth at a garden party some little time ago, Mrs. Straker, said Holmes. No, sir, you're mistaken. Dear me, why, I could have sworn to it. You wore a costume of dove-colored silk with ostrich feather trimming. I never had such a dress, sir, answered the lady. Ah, that quite settles it, said Holmes, and with an apology, he followed the inspector outside. So now Holmes knows that the dress, which cost 22 guineas, is not for Mrs. Straker, and that most likely Straker was leading a double life and maintaining a mistress on the side. So Holmes knows that Straker and another household. Later he comes to the question of what has happened to the horse, and even though Holmes clearly suffered from Asperger's syndrome, right, there's lots of hints of that, he nonetheless shows a mastery of second-order epistemic reasoning by putting himself in the horse's mind. And maybe this is a little like Temple Grandin, who has less understanding of people, but excellent understanding of animals. And so Holmes says, it's this way, Watson. We may leave the question of who kills John Straker for the instant and confine ourselves to finding out what has become of the horse. Now, supposing that he broke away during or after the tragedy, where could he have gone to? The horse is a very gregarious creature. If left to himself, his instincts would have been either to return to King's Pilot, which is where he's being raised from, or go over to Maple. Why should he run wild upon the moon? He would surely have been seen by now, and why should gypsies kidnap him? These people always clear out when they hear of trouble, for they do not wish to be pestered by the police. And there are a lot of signs that Conan Doyle was sort of politically correct, so to say, in the sense that there are many of his stories which show that in his attitude towards people of different races or ethnic backgrounds, Doyle was very, very liberal. So they could not hope to sell such a horse. They would run a great risk and gain nothing by taking him. Surely that's clear. So the gypsies could not have stolen him. And where is he then? I've already said that he must have gone to King's Pilot, which is where he belongs, or to Mapleton, which is a stable that owned him before. He's not at King's Pilot, therefore he's in Mapleton. Let's take that as a working hypothesis and see what it leads us to. This part of the moor, as the inspector remarked, is very hard and dry, but it falls away towards Mapleton, and you can see from here that there is a long hollow over yonder, which must have been very wet on Monday night. So if the supposition is correct, then the horse must have crossed that, and there is the point where we should look for the tracks. So he does find the horse's track on the other side of the hollow and learns that the horse is in fact at Mapleton. And he also forms a theory of how Straker came to die. Having finished his inquiries, Holmes is now ready to leave the site of the crime and return to London. And this is a very famous remark, which you can actually Google. Colonel Ross still wore an expression which showed his poor opinion which he had formed of my companion's ability, and I saw by the inspector's face that his attention had been keenly aroused. You consider that to be important, he asked. Exceedingly so. And is there any other point to which you would wish to draw my attention? And he says, to the curious incident of the dog in the night. But the dog did nothing in the night time. That was the curious incident, remarked Sherlock Holmes. Holmes is pointing out that since the dog did not bark, no stranger was involved in the crime. It turns out that the criminal was Mr. Traker, who was well known to the dog and had taken the horse out in the moor in order to injure him slightly and prevent him from winning the horses. But this was a racehorse, a spirited animal, and he would not allow himself to be cut without protest. So he lashed out with his foot, killing Mr. Straker, and he headed for Mapleton, his original stable, and since they had their own horse in the race, they hit Silver Blaze. So after they realize that the jig is up, they agree with Holmes to arrange for Silver Blaze to run, and he wins the race. So Michael Shwe, in his forthcoming book about Jane Austen as a game, also discusses game theoretic issues arising in literature, but epistemic considerations do not play a major role. I mean, the book is, I think, titled Jane Austen, Game Theorist. But they do in his earlier book, Rational Ritual. Now, this is my last story. In this story by O. Henry, James Dillingham Young and his wife Della are a couple living in a modest flat. They each have one possession in which they take pride, Della's beautiful long flowing hair and Jim's gold watch, which had belonged to his father and grandfather. On Christmas Eve, with only $1.87 in hand and desperate to find a gift for Jim, Della sells her hair for $20 and eventually finds a platinum fob chain for Jim's watch for $21. So she's happy to have found the perfect gift. She's given up her hair, but she has a gift for her husband. So she runs home and begins to prepare dinner. When Jim comes home, he looks at his short-haired wife with a strange expression. Della then admits to Jim that she sold her hair to buy him his Christmas present. And the dumbfounded Jim then gives Della her present, an array of expensive combs for her hair. Della shows Jim the chain she bought for him, and Jim responds that he sold his watch to get the money to buy her combs. So they are now left with gifts that neither one can use, but they also realize how far they are each willing to go to show their love for each other. So the story ends with the narrator comparing the pair's mutually sacrificial gifts of love with those of the biblical magi who brought gifts for Jesus. So in the following game, Della is the row player and Jim the column player, and again there is a default row and a default column. So the payoffs given are only the surface payoff. The -10, -10 in the bottom right corner becomes 100-100 once they realize how much he loves the other. So Della's default is that Jim keeps his watch. And under that, her dominant strategy is to sell hair, which gives her a payoff of 5 rather than 0. Similarly, for Jim, the default situation is that she keeps her hair, which is the top row, and if she does keep her hair, then his dominant strategy is to sell watch, which gives him a payoff of 5. So they each carry out the dominant strategy based on default assumptions, and they end up in the bottom right corner with -10. But then, of course, they realize how much each loves the other, and that payoff becomes positive. So the situation is somewhat analogous to the iterated elimination of dominating strategies, which is a technique used in game theory. But what we have here is not an elimination of dominating strategies, but an elimination of non-default strategies. So there might be some room for looking at a connection between game theory and default logic. Now, there are other examples of manipulation of behavior by manipulating knowledge and belief even earlier, like Yudhishthira's famous remark, Narova Kunjarova, addressed to Drona during the Battle of Mahabharata. Shall I explain it? Yeah. So in this story, the two pairs of cousins, Pandavas and Kauravas, are fighting the huge Battle of Mahabharata. And on the Kaurava side is Drona, who is a powerful warrior and the teacher in bowmanship of both the power of both the Pandavas and the Kauravas. So the Pandavas don't know what to do because they can't deal with him. At this point, the wily Krishna suggests a trick. Because Drona's son was called Ashwatthama and the Pandavas owned an elephant also called Ashwatthama. So they kill the elephant and then they spread the story, Ashwatthama is dead, Ashwatthama is dead. So Drona is not quite convinced, and he asks Yudhishthira, who is the oldest of the Pandava brothers and had a reputation for saintliness. So he asks Yudhishthira, is it true that Ashwatthama is dead? And Yudhishthira says, yes, he's dead. And then the famous remark, Narova Kunjarova, means either man or elephant, uttered in a low voice. So Drona puts down his weapons, and very soon he's killed. Another example occurs in the Old Testament, where Rahab the prostitute protects two Israeli spies by hiding them and lying about them to the king's soldier. And the Trojan horse is another example of knowledge and belief manipulation. There is one other example which is extremely amusing, is Saki's story, Tobermory. So a cat learns to talk, and it turns out that the cat has a lot of information about people's private lives, which they would prefer not to be revealed. Julian Assange, though not a cat, also did talk more than was good for him. And they both came to a bad end. Okay, so I want to say there are various morals we can draw from these great writers. Then instead of concentrating on update by hearing a sentence, we could also allow more general updates by witnessing an event. We could take better account of default reasoning, because many of these stories come from the fact that people are using default reasoning, which is incorrect in the situation. And we could take better account of inferring someone's beliefs in terms of how they act, because normally we tend to go forward. Here is belief, here is this desire, then comes the action. But very often in real life, we already know somebody's preferences, we see how they acted, and from that we can work backwards to their beliefs, right? And in fact, what Rinek has said about the crows, it's essentially the same thing, because we can't ask the crow a question, but we can see what the crow did, and then we infer his beliefs. So thanks to Stephen Brams, Yang Liu, Carol Parikh, who's sitting here, Prashant Parikh, Paul Peterson, Stephen Pinker, Hilary Putnam. I put their names basically as a kind of a decoration, because all they did was, I liked it. So I consider that a faithful comment. Nosen Janowski and Rudy Ye. And now, thank you for listening, and please enjoy your